Good evening, everybody. I guess this is the thank you part. So I'm really, you know, glad to be here. Really honored to be here because we came from so far, and everybody welcomed us like we've been in Barnard in Colombia since a decade. You know? So it's very important for us. And I just want you to explain what's going to happen now. We saw the dance party, the Bolewa, Flora, and Denis Kashito, the drummer, tried to, with the drummers, they permit us to raise consciousness about what's going on in Congo. Two decade crisis, and how dance can help women to heal from sexual trauma. So the thing is that now, with the brilliant panel that I have, we're going to try to just think it through with a lot of different perspectives, because life is just a matter of perspective. And the more perspective you get, the more you are insightful on a subject. So the thing is that we will start with a discussion, and the order of, we start with Paul Scolieri first. After that, Yvette, Christiansë, then Patricia Williams, Terry McGovern, and last but not least, Rita Charon. And the thing is that you guys all have between 7 and 10 minutes. Is that okay for you? Don't break the rules. And yeah, the thing is that bringing the politics, the activism, law, and health also, and doing our best to let you think it through and see how it can be helpful and useful to this tragedy. So now I'm going to leave the floor to Mr. Scott.
Thank you all. It's a pleasure to be here. I was very excited to come to, and I'm not sure, is Bolewa joining us for this?
He should be. He's sending his condolences.
So he's saying goodbye. Understood. So I'm excited to know more about his process and his work with Dr. Mukwege and at the Ponzi Institute. And I was asked just to make some brief remarks about the ways his work and work among other dancers and activists, how their work deals with dance and movement therapy. So I am not a dance and movement therapist, but my training in movement analysis at the Laban Martinez Center, it forms the basis of this modality of training that was really established in the US and in Europe in the 1940s. Rudolf Laban was a movement theorist, and Irmgard Martinez was one of his greatest exponents who applied his theories of movement to the study and healing of children with polio here in New York City. So that was really one of the, she was key in establishing it as a field. For those who aren't familiar, dance and movement therapy is, as it sounds, one of the major modalities, along with drama therapy and music therapy and visual arts therapy, a way of using the creative energy to restore and help survivors and those suffering from social or physical disease and illness back to the sense of reintegration. And as I understand it, the Ponzi Institute in the Congo actually has, if you go to their website, a really fabulous site dedicated to how music therapy is integrated among the women survivors of sexual violence, and who they are actually writing and recording their own music. And dance is also a part of that program, but it was really exciting to see that use. Typically, and more traditionally, dance therapy is practiced one-on-one in medical and mental hospitals, in clinics, rehabilitation centers, and schools, and in private practice. Though in recent years, we've seen a necessary and largely inspiring uptick in applications of movement therapy to groups in refugee and resettlement camps, trauma centers, to deal with populations ravaged by war, forced migration. So we see this all over the world, and the work that Ponzi that Bolewa is involved in is part of a large network of artists working in all regions of the world. So my interest in dance and movement therapy is not only because of my sort of root in as a movement theorist, but also as a dance historian. I see many of my students here, and as Bolewa suggested, the history of dance all traces its way back to rituals of healing and social justice. In my class of world dance, we're reading how some of the greatest thinkers from Rumi to Plato and Confucius all write about dance as a practice of regulation and modulation, whether it's the body that's under attack needing healing, or whether it's the body politic. And in some way, we're just beginning to relearn the lessons that we somehow knew thousands of years ago. Although movement, dance, and therapy are not largely recognized within the medical industrial complex, there are pockets of places where it's been applied and studied, and the empirical evidence to support its use is gaining traction day by day. So just to say something about some of the forms that dance therapy takes, one of its primary modes is as a diagnostic tool, and so this usually involves a therapist supporting a patient through physical movement exercises or structured improvisation to ascertain unconscious or otherwise unspeakable memories and experiences that the body can relay. So this is the underlying idea of this sort of a deep body language study, but how a movement therapist is trained in looking at how the body's shape, its rhythm, its use of energy, its use of space, all can say something about trauma and experience and memory that somehow might be beyond the reach of discourse, something that trauma might have rendered somehow unspeakable. And a therapist can somehow uses movement as a way to open up channels of consciousness for that experience. The other large way is through rehabilitation, using dance and music to support body-mind connectivity for both its functionality and expressivity. So this can mean a number of things: using dance to restore mobility or sensation that has been lost either because of a physical disease or trauma. Sometimes these losses can be healed through movement repatterning based on developmental movement patterns we acquire as we learn to grow from infant to we're standing and jumping. So a lot of these exercises are adopted to regain those strategies of standing strong and tall. To promote sensation and consciousness of emotion through motion, this is where dancing is a means to express or embody or teaching us how dances actually teach us to experience and identify emotion, sometimes motion that's beyond intelligibility. To honor or translate important lessons that our moving bodies know about power and agency. These have to do with lessons about how we know how to orient ourselves in the world, or to establish presence, to negotiate space, to differentiate the self from the other, and learning how to act. And more generally, using dance to experience pleasure, joy, ease of movement, pain management, connection to culture. This is one of the major ways within refugee camps that dancers are used, using traditional dance and also creative composition to help survivors and displaced persons to reconnect to some notion of culture itself. So I'm excited here to have this opportunity to hear from Bolewa today and to hear more about his approach to working with the women in the Congo and how he sees his project, Lowen. Yes, John.
Hello.
Welcome. And how it fits into the wider landscape of dance and movement therapy, although your work intersects many discourses and areas of knowledge, as this panel attests to. So thank you so much for your performance in Mondo. Thank you.
An onlooker whose looking is participant,
is participant and it's receptor of the performers and the performance. And I'm reminded of a frequently deployed analogy between poetry and dance. It's an analogy that is most likely predicated upon an attempt to find language that escapes instrumentality through pure expressivity, or the staging of language, or a theatrics of language that doesn't actually give up its obligation to codes. There's still a relationship to the syntactical structure, the relationship between a verb, a noun, and those beautiful, often overlooked gestures of punctuation, the humble comma. Dance, as I understand it, shares with poetry a refusal to become simply a means to an end. And it's what Paul Valéry, forgive my French pronunciation, I told you it's a start of war, but Paul Valéry, called the going nowhere of language. There's a politics to this. The dancer moves within the space of the stage, of a communal hall, or a designated public space, but does not go anywhere, doesn't do any work for the nation. The dance happens in place, and it happens to be seen. But what does it mean to be seen if the dancer is a woman who has been violated, and whose body has been made the terrain through which men do war with each other, and through which all these international corporations do their work? Coltan, so that we can communicate with each other. Gas and petroleum, so that we can reach each other across distances. What does it mean if a woman is the person who is paying a certain price for it? Writing of the sexual violence in the eastern region of the Democratic Republic of Congo, Jocelyn Kelly notes that destruction is the word most frequently used to describe the consequences of such violence. The scope of this word is so encompassing. It encompasses the psychological, the physiological effects of individual women, as well as the psychological and social health of their families and their communities. One destructive consequence is how survivors are treated within those units, family, community. Another destructive consequence is how that woman is seen. How is she seen if she's known to be a survivor? Is she the sign that sex happened? Is she the sign of sex? Is she the sign of something that is private, is so visible and haunting, and circulating every time she moves? Is she the suspected being of the bearer of sexually transmitted infection? How is she seen? And how does she bear being seen? Attending to the work that Bolewa Sabourin, it's very important. Accent is, pronunciation is always locally inflected. It has its, one honors that, but we must make an effort to reach forward. So even though my name is Yvette, I do not speak French. So attending to the work, attending to la création, I'm so aware of what it means to talk about destruction in the space of la création. And I think that something astonishing happened watching and in the space of seeing that this work opens for us. And it's the ritualized language of dance that Paul just referred to, because there's another set of analogies that is at play as well. Dance to ritual, ritual to language, and ritual and language. And ritual encompasses those formalized bodily practices that include repetition. And in the narratives we heard tonight, repetition, and the exchangeability of agents of violence, the Portuguese, the American, the Belgian. And then we also have that the repetitions of violence in the domestic, the waltz, the dance macabre. So I was aware of this. Then what does as a non-dance scholar, what do I understand? That dance is an art form that makes its structure, its codes, and languages of gesture visible. And in ritual gestures, they do not have to be read as the expression of the particular subject's expression. But they allow the particular to be brought into view in a designated space. And what I've understood, just amazing, just astonishing, is that in the giving to receive, the women whose narratives we heard and the dancers who may dance in those spaces that you create for them have privacy behind the ritual, behind the gesture. And I cannot think of a more political, powerful refusal to be made invisible in that granting of a public privacy. The woman who participates in dance and whose movement is not simply that of a body walking from A to B, but that of a body moving for movement's sake, going nowhere, obeying only the dance, may strangely be afforded that public privacy behind a formalized bodily practice. And I'm thinking here there's something else that happens, that there's a silence. Even though we've heard these narratives tonight, I don't know if I can yet call them narratives, because that means we're putting them to do a certain work, and we're asking them to be evidence maybe before they're ready to be there. But, and maybe story, to having read your work, that the stories that must be told, maybe story, account, these are words that one reaches for. Even those narratives and the dance afford a silence, because the relationship between the spoken word and the dance reminds me of how sedimented language is, and how a woman coming back from a horrendous experience, a violated experience, re-enters languages that are so sedimented and so coded, and that the dance is a way of the language of gesture that just gives her a break, that just gives her a space that pauses verbal in which the accusation resides. And in South Africa, what the praise singer says is, Titi Lile, I vanish.
Yes.
That's so evocative. I too am going to toss some of what I was going to say, because actually I wish I had more time to reflect on what you said, but you know, when you say silence, I think of trauma itself as a wound so deep, and as I know analytically, it is a wound so deep that it knocks language from you, and that the only expression possible is therefore either reenactment or reiteration in some formative sense. And it seems to me that dance is one form of healing precisely because of that. But the ability to reclaim the silence and to the degree that you're speaking about as a form of ritual actually reminds me, there's a wonderful quote, and I don't have it at the top of my head, from a book by Seligman and others called Ritual and Its Consequence. And they actually say that ritual and repetition, precisely what you're talking about, I think is a form of the subjunctive. And so this is really, it seems to me that the part of the performative value of this is that it creates a kind of subjunctive space in which we see the ought and the should and what ought to be. And that seems to be part of the power of this. And I was really struck in listening to Mr. Sabourin's TED talk, in which he talked, my body is my identity. And it was this sense of, you know, that is also reflected in the title, the Hajj. It is this sense of inspiration. It's also grabbing the breath, because one thing trauma does is knock the breath out of you in some ways. And that breath is what we speak with in this, which ties into kind of poetry. And until very recently, I also didn't realize that the word law in English, not legal and other than the sort of the embellishments of the word law, but law itself. Legal is from a Latin root, but law is from Old Norse, I think. And it actually means a stroke, a beat. It means, it is actually a musical reference to a drum. And it refers to an ordering of life, and it is, and so it is, so good law is a kind of good regulation of timing. of when to go in and when to go out.
Mm-hmm.
And I was so struck during the course of you were talking about the absence of laws when corruption begins, it's when there is chaos of some kind. It's when we don't know when to enter and we crash into each other, we violate each other. Again, I'm sort of tossing my hopes, but somewhere between this notion of my body is my identity is where, you know, when you were invited to dance, to come in and dance at the end, where I felt very self-conscious, this is not who I am, to sort of leap in and dance at the end, performance like that, particularly when a subject was so unsettling.
Yeah.
But somewhere in the back of my mind, I heard my grandmother's voice, who is a, you know, whose own mother was born in slavery. And what I grew up with was a message that they can own your body, but they can't own you, which is intention, I think, with that grasping of the body as my identity. I was invited, I became a good lawyer because, you know, I basically left my body because you can own that. You have claims on that, you know, in contract. You know, there is a way in which you treat my body like an ashtray. But, you know, I can go into my head or into someplace else where you can't control how I breathe, or you can't tell me what to do. And that's something I've struggled with in this profession, to bring my body back into the practice of law, to really bring my body into the rhythm that makes or enters what I think not just law, but justice is about, which is that subjunctive space of what ought to be, what should be. And that preparation and that practice of ritual that is about the creation of new worlds, the recreation of new worlds. And it's not just theatrical, it is dreamlike in that sense. There's a friend of mine who's been writing about Siberian practice, an old Siberian practice of when they go out on a bear hunt, they do this dance ritual to prepare how to kill the bear. And it's very, very ritualized over 1,000 years of how to kill the bear. And yet, when you look at the history of how they kill bears, it's nothing like that. I mean, they just go out and they slaughter these bears and they violate every rule. She said, but the ritual is really important because it pulls before you how it ought to be done. Even when you fail, it's a calling to account. And so I, you know, at the end, as, you know, I tried to drag my little lawyer myself to the end of that ring and try to listen the rhythm of these stories in a way of what they wished they would have been, and to get it out of what I think when Fanon talked about cigarettes, I mean, when I was listening to that, when Fanon talks about, you know, there are ways in which I relate to my body. There is, you know, the eye in which I take a cigarette and I reach over, I get the pack, I inhabit the eye. And then he talked about, you know, than I am in you, I'm a second person. But the difficulty of race is that you are this web of stories written by others, and that's the one that doesn't breathe because there is no interior, there's no regard for the interior. It is simply, you know, the accumulation of stories through which you have to, press to present yourself. And I just thought that the both the presentation and the very end, you know, dragged me back from, you know, the mentality of my own little notebook of notes of what I might say, back into my body to exhale after all of those stories. So I thank you, Messi.
Interventions enhance health status is largely unknown. What did you call it, the biomedical industrial complex? I want to actually go back and talk about some of the things that I've seen in my long career. very early on when women were getting HIV and they were dying but didn't have AIDS because the definition was based on men, I watched women do theater in churches and community centers to express what was happening to their bodies because they were completely left out of the policy discourse. I went to ACT UP and I saw them use theater in St. Patrick's Cathedral to say, F you, we're dying of AIDS, Catholic Church, you can't continue this. It seemed to me art was, they used art to change the media response. So it has been such a part of everything that I've ever seen in public health. So to read that sentence is very devastating. Now, I want to move to the personal because it relates very much to what I'm seeing now in formalized gender-based violence interventions. So in 2001, my mother was killed in the World Trade Center, and I went to the trauma therapy, and they wanted me to focus on how she died and say it over and over and over again while they took my blood pressure, and which taught me that they really don't know what they're doing often in trauma. And so what I did instead was I wrote a play based on all the people like me who were caught in this global event, which had interplay between global policy, which was being used in the name of everything we hated, and yet we were these human beings who had lost a human being. So it was that same interplay that I think you got at in this dance, when human beings are caught in history and policy and used in various ways. I thought that this performance captured that so beautifully. I think that, you know, having had all these experiences when I'm in the School of Public Health and I look at what are the most well-funded interventions around gender-based violence, they're very siloed. Some people fund economics, some funding of self-esteem. There's all of these different kind of little interventions that actually often don't deal with the structural factors and actually don't deal with the body and the history of what is happening to women's bodies. So I think, you know, I think that the trauma experience which evades discourse, you said, I think that all of these tools, law, public health, are inadequate to address what you were able to express in dance. And I think that, you know, we absolutely have got to rethink, you know, how we can make these type of interventions much more available. And actually, you know, there are all of these things, like to prove that something works, you use in public health these biomedical measurements, which are totally inappropriate for these issues we're talking about. So so thank you so much for this.
Paradox of the woman whose body has
been part of a betrayal, that it was the instrument of her betrayal. If she didn't have a body, she wouldn't have been betrayed. So it's the paradox of that, and at the same time that she has to get her body back, that it's been taken away, and she has to get it back. She has to re-embody, which is, I think, the point of bringing her to the dance. Now, there was a moment in the performance that took my breath away. It was close to the end. You were doing what I recall as the most stylized movements. It kind of looked like Indian dance movements. You were swiveling your hands. Do you remember? I mean, I'm sure you remember. It was highly stylized, and it was almost contorting the things that you were doing, especially with your upper body was contorted, and you were kind of bent in the. But do you remember what your partner was doing? I mean, of course you do. But while he is doing the most stylized, like riveting, like stylish, I have to get up and show you. This is what the woman was doing. Look, this is what the woman was doing. You remember?
Yeah.
Like this. And he's doing all of that in the back. And she's like, where are the pieces? Do you remember?
Yeah.
And that was the moment that I knew what you were saying. That not only is there this paradox between you're taking my body away, you're not letting me get it back, but also the rivenness between the two. Because up until then, they were together. Up until then, they were mirroring one another, pretty much. And then, boom, you're doing that, and she's doing that. And I said, she's lost. She's gone. So that spoke. And so, you know, many times I will, like, listen to the lungs, listen to a heart, examine the abdomen. When there's no real need to, I'm not going to learn anything new from listening to the lungs that I know very well. And yet I listen to the lungs because of the ritual part of that we're acting something out together. And of course, there's no physical exam that's not done without the full partnership of the person being examined. You know, breathe in, breathe out. So that's a beauty of this Western medicine, that it lets us do that. But then I remember your words that the Western medicine has failed us. And there's nothing in Western medicine or psychiatry that is helping these women, and then you have to go elsewhere. So that it is a story of the failure of these little things that we have. So what an evening of paradox, that in some way, were there to be a means of restoring restoring simply the who it belongs to. But even we, in all our goodwill, don't know how to do that. And nobody's forgetting the legacy of Marion Sims and all the Western doctors who have been abusing women for centuries. And it's not only the kind of torture that you're describing, but is an ordinary part of organized medicine as well. So these are the thoughts that come. The rivenness between persons that is the end result of this kind of trauma, and then the promise maybe that there be some kind of rapprochement between the one trying to help and the one in need of help, but then the regret that it happened so rarely.
To find a way to integrate, to
to have trust that they were going to be able to be integrated into the community.
On faisait par exemple ce qu'on a fait tout à l'heure, c'est-à-dire qu'une personne montre un mouvement et tout le monde fait la même chose et on fait le tour comme ça du groupe et ça fait qu'on met tout le monde en situation de leadership et tout le monde en situation de suiveur.
So precisely the exercise that we did where one person would do a movement and then the whole group would then do the movement together. And each person in the group would have that experience so that they would have the experience of both being a leader and also somebody who was following.
Ça permet. On essayait aussi de leur faire justement avec ces mouvements-là de créer une chorégraphie qui reprenait du coup chacun de leurs mouvements et qui du coup créait une chorégraphie qui leur appartenait et n'était pas quelque chose. Et moi je faisais le lien entre tout ça.
So from each individual movement, they would chain together a dance choreography that would then belong to the whole group. And it would have been a sort of co-creation of everybody who was there.
Du coup ça devenait un peu la chorégraphie du groupe de la communauté. Et elle pouvait après jouer avec en dehors des ateliers.
And so that was something that they created together and that they could then use even outside of the workshops as something that they had constructed and that they shared and that they could then play with, that they could experiment with or change, but that it was something that really belonged to them.
Mais on pouvait aussi partir d'une histoire que quelqu'un nous avait racontée, qu'une des filles nous raconte, et qu'on décide du coup de trouver un moyen de le danser, chacun à sa manière.
Or it could be a situation where it would be more word based, and a woman would give a word or a phrase to use, and that based on that expression, that verbal expression, they would then find movements to express it.
Et du coup, ça, en fait, après, on se mettait toujours donc en rond, on est toujours en rond pour signifier la communauté. Et en fait, on marche tout le temps, et quand quelqu'un le sent, il rentre dans le cercle et il commence à exprimer ce qu'il a envie d'exprimer. Soit la thématique a été donnée au début, soit quelque chose d'autre, mais ça, c'est à la regarder.
Another exercise would be for them all, because they always work in circles, in a circle. They would all start moving, walking slowly, and then whenever somebody in the group felt the need to express something, that person would come to the center of the group and express, and it could either be about the theme that had been proposed for the day, or it could be anything else, really. And so it would be that kind of, you know, and then the person would back into the circle, and it would be that kind of activity of moving from the periphery.
Et après, une fois que on faisait tous ces ateliers, le psychologue qui était congolais et de la région, lui repartait de ces moments-là pour leur faire mettre des mots sur ce qu'elles ont.
And so afterwards, the psychologist who was a Congolese psychologist and who knew about the history and felt the culture, would take what he or she had observed and then use it to put words to help put words to the situation, to what he saw them experience and what.
Et c'est ainsi qu'on a décidé du coup de revenir en France pour améliorer justement les différents ateliers que l'on pouvait faire et surtout le lien dès le début de binôme entre danseur et psychothérapeute, de ne pas avoir justement deux parties mais juste un seul et même partie qui vont travailler ensemble et dans la réflexion sur et le mouvement.
And so they came back to France and they're trying to think through the workshops they've already developed, but thinking through other workshops as well, but with the sense of always having a dual dyad between having a dancer and also a therapist, so that you can really unite in all situations in movement and therapy expression. It's a co-therapy.
Now we can go in the question box, and people don't get into these problems.
So, what happens with music? Because that's a very integral part of this, right? The drums, the voice. Is this part of the therapy as well? And is it mainly done by men, or are women also sometimes singers?
La musique est très importante et l'avantage de la musique congolaise, mais de bien d'autres musiques, mais moi je connais la congolaise, c'est que en fait il faut surtout suivre le rythme, et le rythme représente et rappelle, c'est un peu une métaphore du cœur qui bat, et ensuite les mouvements eux se construisent autour de ce rythme-là.
So the music is very important, and in this case it's Congolese music particularly, because it gives a beat, and a beat that is meant to emulate a heartbeat, and all the movements then get coordinated with that kind of primal pulse.
Souvent, ce qui était les meilleurs moments, c'était à la City of Joy, parce que certaines jouaient de la percussion, et ce qui était quelque chose vraiment de powerful, parce que souvent, on interdisait au Congo les femmes à jouer de la percussion.
And so it was at the City of Joy where really there was the most rich experience, because there were women there who were playing drums, and in the Congo it's forbidden or taboo for women to play drums. And so it was a transgressive acclamation power.
Du coup, elle pouvait passer de la danse à la musique, toujours en gardant ce rythme.
So it would be a fluid passing between the music and the dance, with the music as the kind of the glue between.
Ce qui est aussi important à savoir, c'est que elles sont complètement déconnectées, déphasées, décyclées, elles sont plus, et du coup le rythme, c'est quelque chose qui leur permet justement de trouver une certaine régularité et de retrouver quelque chose dans leur tête qui leur permet justement de suivre comme ça. Parce qu'on vit tous en fait sous un rythme, et quand il nous arrive ce genre de trauma, ça nous déboussole, et donc le rythme, c'est une manière de se réancrer dans leur vie en fait.
Mm-hmm. And that often the women who had experienced these things would come, and they'd be disconnected, and they'd be out of sync, and they would have, you know, lost kind of the ordering beat to their lives, and that it's really through the dance and through the rhythm and the grounding of that heartbeat that they're able to kind of reconnect to themselves.
Et du coup, le rythme va aussi avec la chanson, parce que la chanson aussi est très rythmée. Et donc, vraiment au Congo, on tourne vraiment, contrairement à l'Occident, où on aime sortir du rythme, casser justement les choses. Au Congo, on aime vraiment être sur les temps, sur le rythme. Et donc, les chants, la danse et la percussion, tout ça, sont vraiment très connectés, donc ça leur permet de se reconnecter.
So in the Congo, and the kind of music from the Congo, unlike in Western music, often where you're trying to do syncopation, where it's kind of playing with the rhythm and trying to break the rhythm, here it's really trying to accentuate the coherence and unity of the music and the dance and the movement. So that you have that constant.
C'est un peu comme quand on est petit, qu'on apprend à jouer sur piano, on met le métronome et on se doit d'apprendre à maîtriser ça avant de pouvoir sortir. Et bien nous, on a besoin de les reconnecter à ce métronome.
It's about things, I either they can talk about it or they, you know, they can make the choice and just not do that movement. It's but the key is really the awareness. Oftentimes, I think they have a hard time even just saying, oh, that doesn't feel good to me.
In looking at the facts and figures in the open, I saw that there are some men and boys that also have been violated. And so I'm curious about whether they participate if they're, or if they don't self-identify, or if there's another group that they participate in, or if there's an outlet for them, or if they're included in any way. Anyway.
Shared. And
et surtout elle touche notre révolution numérique.
Yes, and particularly it touches this internet age, the information age, and the way we do business in the world, the way we talk to each other. I would guess that probably everybody in this room has a cell phone.
Me first. Les cinq plus grandes entreprises qu'il y a aujourd'hui dans le monde n'existaient même pas il y a 25 ans. Et donc, aujourd'hui, juste en 2003-2004, Sony a failli couler parce que le Congo avait bloqué à cause d'une guerre civile le coltan. Et Sony n'a pas pu sortir sa PlayStation 2. À partir de ce jour-là, toutes les entreprises et toutes les sous-entreprises ont pris leur disposition pour que plus jamais ça n'arrive.
In 2002-2003, Sony almost went underwater. Their businesses were underwater, at least they were in great financial trouble because there was a civil war and they weren't able to access the coltan. And in order to be able to launch their PlayStation 2 on time, and since that time, all of the five top companies, IBM, Apple, Canon, Sony, all of the companies are making sure that that doesn't happen again.
Et du coup, le Rwanda, qui est le pays limitrophe, qui est juste à côté, qui fait un centième du Congo, il est aujourd'hui plus riche que le Congo, 100 fois plus riche que le Congo, est le premier exportateur de coltan. Et du coup, aujourd'hui, la situation fait que c'est tellement multifactoriel qu'on ne sait pas par quel bout le prendre.
So Rwanda, which is right on the border on the east, has become the first exporter of coltan.
Alors qu'ils ont 0% de coltan.
All while they have no coltan. So it's all being funneled to Rwanda. And and so it's you don't, there's no clear way on how to sort of address the problem because all of these, there are all of these kind of different threads that are working together to keep this situation in place. Mm-hmm. And the financial stakes are huge.
Il faudrait en même temps salir l'image des grosses entreprises du numérique par les individus en utilisant le net comme s'il se retournait contre lui-même, contre ses créateurs que nous sommes, mais en même temps une intervention de l'ONU sur le Rwanda. Et en même temps, une intervention de l'ONU sur le Congo, parce que c'est eux les premiers aussi qui vendent le pays. Donc, on ne sait pas par quel bout rentrer.
You need everybody to sort of have an uprising on the internet against these huge companies, to use the means they created against them. You have to get the UN involved to do sanctions on Rwanda and also on the Congo. There's just a huge collusion in making sure that this situation stays as it is.
Du coup, ces femmes doivent lutter contre la terre entière.
So really, these women are having to fight against the world.
This project right now.
disciplinary studies to create a series of brown bag lunches for faculty, students, and staff. We really have to be inclusive and have those community members, and to discuss, to teach us about what is happening in the indigenous communities. So we've identified that as a really pressing need for us. So I think we still do need to be active. So thank you for raising that.
So I teach an environmental justice class. A huge part of it is around indigenous people and the exploitation and a lot of things around women and all of the issues that are happening, everything from the impacts, health impacts caused by the contamination to the, you know, rampant sexual violence. So we have a lot of work trying to change the structures around all of that. Very, very difficult right now. Needless to say, because this administration has rolled back even a few regulations that were there, but we are very much working on it.
Does anybody in the panel wants to say something about what's going to be our next question? So I'm sad, but it's like it's almost 9:30, and the farmer has to continue dealing with all stuff, and we already exceed the time we have left. So I just want to invite on behalf of myself, Bolewa, Lauren, Barnard, Colinda, to thank everybody for being here, staying that late, and also thank the panel who had few time to prepare and work on that. And we are so grateful, to be here, also grateful to be in the United States, talking about something that we try to raise consciousness in France, because we are all African descent. And this is, I tried writing Bolivar's life story because I think it was the most powerful thing I could do to help to raise consciousness to Congo. And so this is my part. Bolivar's done has done also his part. Dr. Mukwege all do is a everyday struggle with a similar job. And we just want you to know that we really appreciate the moment we spend with you. And just for people who can read French, there's books behind about Bolivar's life story. And if you are interested, you can go and have a book and we can Brood is our.
And we're going to be having another event tomorrow at 7 p.m. where Bala and Bolewa are going to be talking about the book, and that will be taking place here as well. So please come back. The book is fabulous, and we are actually so, so grateful to Lori. She has a class, a translation class, that she's teaching, and they are translating the book. So.